Please rise. Please remain for Negaraku and Putra Gemilang. Ladies and gentlemen, you may be seated. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh and good morning. Yang berbahagia Profesor Dato' Dr. Muhammad Azmi Muhammad Lila, Deputy Vice Chancellor, Research and Innovation, University Putra Malaysia. Yang berbahagia Profesor Dr. Zainal Abidin Talib, the Dean of Faculty of Science. Yang berbahagia Profesor Dr. Khuzira Sha'ari, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the inaugural lecture by Professor Dr. Khuzira Sha'ari. To ask for blessing for our program today, we now call upon Ustaz Muhammad Hafiz Ghazali to recite the dua.
ila hadratin nabi mustafa rasulillah sallallahu alaihi wasallam al fatihah a'udzu billahi minasy syaithanir rajim bismillahirrahmanirrahim alhamdulillahirabbil alamin arrahmanir rahim iyyaka na'budu wa iyyaka nasta'in ihdinas siratal mustaqim siratal ladzina an'amta 'alaihim ghairil maghdubi 'alaihim waladdallin amin bismillahirrahmanirrahim الحمد لله الذي أوضح لنا سبيل الهدى والرشاد وجعل في اتباع السلامة من الآفات والمهلكات والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد المبعوث علينا خير خليفة الله في أرضه وأحسن أسوة لنا نقتدي به وعلى آله الطاهرين وأصحابه المجاهدين والمخلصين ومن اهتدى بهديهم إلى يوم الدين اللهم يا محمد يا حفيظ يا الله انكاوري أغنكان لسنجم نموطنا كرحمة kedaulatanmu disanjung di samping tiada yang berhak untuk disembah melainkanmu, ya Allah. Allahumma ya Qahhar, kami bersyukur kepadamu kerana sifat Rahman dan Rahimmu memungkinkan kami berkumpul pada pagi ini untuk majlis yang berkat ini sempena syarahan inaugural Profesor Dr. Khazirah Syari. Allahumma ya Mujib, bantulah kami dalam usaha kami semua untuk menjadi sebuah institusi peneraju dalam penyelidikan dan pembelajaran serta sebagai sebuah universiti yang terbaik. Tolonglah kami meningkatkan usaha untuk mencari ilmu dan penemuan-penemuan baru sebagai suatu inisiatif yang akan membawa faedah kepada agama, negara dan juga rakyat. Allahumma ya mujib ad-da'wat wa ya qadhi al-hajat. Allahumma ya mujib ad-da'wat wa ya qadhi al-hajat. Kami akur bahawa ilmu pengetahuan adalah amanah. Adalah amanahmu yang mesti dijana selari dengan petunjuknya untuk manfaat manusia. Anggaplah pencarian ilmu dan usaha kami mengintegrasikan sumber-sumber ilmu wahyu dengan sains sosial, kemanusiaan, teknologi sebagai suatu ibadah demi pembangunan dan pengayaan tradisi intelektual kami dan kemajuan Islam dan juga negara. Allahumma ya Muhammad ya Hafiz, ya Jabbar, anugerahlah hidayahmu agar kami dapat membincangkan bersama permasalahan umat Islam pada hari ini dan dapat kami menyelesaikannya. Allahumma ya Qayyum ya Hayyum ya Qayyum ya Dzal Jalali wal Ikram, anugerahkanlah bantuanmu agar kami memperolehi semula keagungan dan kegemilangan ilmuan dan ketamadunan kami. Allahumma rabbana atina fid dunya hasanah wa fil akhirati hasanah wa qina adzabannar wa sallallahu ala sayyidina Muhammad walhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Taqabbalallahu minkum.
Thank you to Ustaz Muhammad Hafiz Ghazali for the dua recitation. Ladies and gentlemen, we would like to call upon Yang Berbahagia Profesor Datuk Dr. Muhammad Azmi Muhammad Lila, Deputy Vice Chancellor, Research and Innovation, University Putra Malaysia, to chair and introduce the speaker for today's inaugural lecture. Yang Berbahagia.
Thank you. Thank you to the Masters of Ceremony. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. The person that we're going to celebrate today, Yang Berbahagia Professor Dr. Khazirah Syari, Deans of the Faculties and Directors of Institutes, UPM Senior Officers, Members of Academia, Ladies and Gentlemen. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh and very good morning. Salam sejahtera dan salam satu Malaysia. First and foremost, on behalf of UPM, let me express my greatest appreciations and to welcome all members of the floor and academia for this auspicious inaugural lecture by Yang Berbahagia Professor Dr. Khazirah. Ladies and gentlemen, let me introduce our distinguished speakers today, Professor Dr. Khazirah Syari. Professor Dr. Khazirah Syari was born in 1961. He's still young, in Teluk Intan, Perak, and spent most of school days in Kulim, Kedah, and the Covent School, Secondary School, Butterworth, Seberang Perai, and later at the Alustar Technical School. She later pursued her GCSE levels at Loughborough Technical College in England, and then her BSc Honours degree in Chemistry at the University of Swansea, in Wales, 1984. She came back home, first as a secondary school teacher and later as tutor, during which time she also pursued her master's degree in phytochemistry at UNC Malaya, Kuala Lumpur. After completing her master's, she assumed a position as a research officer at the Forest Research Institute in Kepong, where she worked until middle of 2001. And during this time, she obtained her PhD in phytochemistry from University of Strathclyde in Glasgow. That was from 1992 to 1994. Professor Dr. Khosira first began her career as a researcher in chemistry division, FRIM, where she acquired most of her research skills and built her expertise in phytochemistry. And after receiving her PhD, she was promoted to senior research officer, where she contributed significantly in the planning and setting up of the medicinal plants division in FRIM. Her experience in instruments operations during her PhD studies helped her in the establishments and the operations of the NMR, nuclear magnetic resonance spectroscopy unit, which housed the first 300 megahertz Bruker NMR in Malaysia. So the instrument is still in full operation to today, but the instrument still needs a lot of attention in terms of maintenance and funding as well. Professor Khosira Shahri started her career as an academician in UPM in year 2001 as an associate professor at the Department of Chemistry, Faculty of Science, and her teaching duties comprises teaching organic chemistry spectroscopy courses to students at both undergraduate and postgraduate levels. On several occasions, she was also involved in teaching research methods to postgraduate students. So in research, Professor Khosira, as to this day, an active researcher in the Laboratory of Natural Products at IBS, and she has been affiliated with Institute as an associate researcher since 2001. With a major contribution to the establishment of the laboratories, units and facilities at LHS. She has supervised and co-supervised many postgraduate students in their final year projects, and she was also involved in co-supervising numbers of postgraduate students from other national universities. So her research interest centers around phytochemistry or natural products chemistry and working closely with collaborators in biomedical science, immunology, and pharmacology. The main subjects of studies range from plants, marines, natural products, and microbes. And in recent years, her interests have expanded to applications of phytochemical and spectroscopic methods in system biology research, particularly in metabolomics. So in her research career, she has led and is leading numerous research projects involving a total close to RM7 million in research funds. So over the year, she has authored and co-authored about 120 papers in referee journals, and currently she has attained age index of 15 with more than 1,000 total citations. That is actually a great achievement. Within 5 years after she got the full professor. So she was made a full professor in the year 2010 after serving UPM for 9 years. So her expertise in the fields of natural product chemistry has been recognized nationally and internationally, and she has been invited to give lectures at seminars and conferences, as well as to provide input as a resource person for various technical workshops. So as a reviewer, she sits on editorial boards of phytochemical analysis, a Wiley publication with an impact factor of 2.45, and as an expert panel member, she has been invited as research grant proposal assessor at the Ministry of Agriculture, Ministry of Science, and also KPM. She has served as internal reviewer of postgraduate dissertations for UPM and as external reviewer for postgraduate students at several universities, including UM, UITM, USM, UTM, UKM, and IMU. And as administrator, she was appointed to the Research Management Center in 2010 as deputy director of the research and the research grant division. And last year, she was appointed as a director of RMC until now. So Professor Dr. Shari is also an active member in the Malaysian Natural Product Society, of which she has been the vice president for 3 consecutive terms until year 2016. Together with UPN and this association, she has presided over the organizations of various seminars, conferences, workshops, and national and international levels. Internationally, she's also on the board of the Asian Network of Research and Antibiotic Plants and a constituent member of the Africa, Asia, South America group that coordinates activities of several networks involved in natural products research. She is also a member of the Royal Society of Chemistry, RSC's Malaysia, and also the Asian Phytochemical Society. So this actually to roughly about her background, and then I think many more will come. And then I think without further ado, it's better to listen to the person that who's going to be, we're going to celebrate today. So herewith, may I present to you, ladies and gentlemen, Yang Berbahagia Professor Dr. Khosira Syari with her inaugural lecture entitled Discovering Future Cures from Phytochemistry to Metabolomics. Please welcome her. Yeah.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Terima kasih Datuk. Yang saya hormati, yang berbahagia Datuk Deputy Vice Chancellor of Innovation, Pendidikan dan Innovation, Profesor Datuk Muhammad Azmi bin Ahmad Lela, yang saya hormati dekan saya Prof Zainah, dan juga rakan-rakan lain yang saya hormati sekalian. Thank you so much for being with me today. I am a bit fluttering now actually. But I'll get by inshallah. So thank you so much again for willing to come to spend your time this morning to listen to about my experiences and journey across this globe looking for molecules. Okay, I'm going to talk about the potential of discovering future cures from our vast natural resources. Okay. Let's begin with the bad news first. In communication, that's the first rule. The world is in crisis. Why do I say that? There's pantropical deforestation everywhere. There's increasing fossil fuel use. We're running out of gas. And climate change is causing damaging effects due to global warming. And we are making natural products all the time. There's a big population growth, exploding population growth in the world. It's 7 billion now and going to be 10 billion by 2050. Along with that, people know about SARS, H1N1, Ebola. All these are the new deadly and treatable global diseases that we are expecting with so much changes in the world. And to top that, there are already diseases which does not have any medicines at the moment. We have not solved the problems of that. And now we are facing with new ones coming. Obesity is one of the most prevalent diseases in our country. But take heart, the good news is there is help for us, and this is from our plants. Plants is the other name for medicine. This is where most of our medicine in use now comes from. And we hope there'll be more coming from these plants. Especially the plant kingdom is an underexplored source of chemical entities. There are 300,000 species of higher plants. We have identified those. But this is only 10% that has been phytochemically investigated. And someone might say, well, even pharmacologically tested is also very little, just the tip of the iceberg. So what are we going to do? We are losing our forests at a very fast rate. So we have to find ways to take advantage of the huge treasure that lies within the leaf metabolome, which contains up to several thousands of secondary metabolites, those wonderful molecules that we call phytochemicals. Phytochemicals are very unique It's made by various pathways. I think most of the chemistry students here will who has taken the course on biosynthetic pathways or biosynthetic chemistry with Dr. Gwen or Prof. Nordin here will remember the polyketide pathway, the mevalonate pathways, the shikimate pathways. These are basic chemistry that shows how important molecules like such as steroids, terpenoids, alkaloids are being made. So a bit of basics, what's primary plant metabolism, what is secondary metabolites? If you remember, primary plant metabolism involves essential chemicals like carbohydrates, proteins, and fats, and chlorophylls. Okay, these are they are actually involved in growth and development. What we talk about, plant secondary metabolites, these are chemical byproducts produced from this primary plant metabolism. And most people think that these are waste products. I don't believe so. They are made there. They are made for something, for a purpose. And I go along with the theory that it is a defensive chemicals against predators, parasites, and diseases. And being such a unique group of chemicals, it is accumulated by plant cells in very small quantities, posing a very big challenge to people like me and budding phytochemists in the world on how do we get to isolate them and characterize them. So this is our biggest challenge as phytochemists. So this shows some of the chemical diversity that we can get across the pharmaceutical domain. And for drugs, for example, if you can see looking at the last box there, which shows the drug distribution, you can see that in terms of structure, it mimics so much the distribution of natural products. It shows that it requires a huge diversity in structures in order to have a purpose. And most pharmaceutical companies, they are saying that they have solved the world problem by the development of combinatorial chemistry, where they develop new molecules from their skills and expertise. But if you look at the combinatorial chemistry distribution, it's only right in the middle near the origin. So the diversity there is much less than what we get with natural products. So there again, we show that natural products is the way forward. And the Food Drug Agency has already approved more than 60% of the current drugs in clinical use are actually based from nature. It's either a mimic of nature, it's either a derivative of nature, or they use the natural products to get something to synthesize the drugs, or they could use the drugs directly from nature. So these are some of the well-known plant-derived drugs of lore. Aspirin, digitoxin, everybody knows morphine. And nowadays, people who've got cancer, they look towards vinblastine and vincristine. And people with fungal attack, they look at vancomycin. So here are some sources of plants that produces these wonderful molecules. Like quinine is from cinchona. Cinchona revolutionized the art of medicine as profoundly as gunpowder had the art of war. And tubercurarin from the Amazonia curare. The introduction of tubercurarin way back in 1942 has caused a profound change in the efficacy and safety of anesthesiology, because tubercurarin is actually used as a arrow poison by the natives of the Amazonia. And where I studied in the University of Strathclyde, a group of researchers who discovered tubercurarin managed to synthesize atracurium, which is still making money for my University of Strathclyde until now. And pilocarpine is another one from the Rutaceae, a very small molecule, and Merck is making millions out of it. And not forgetting Marilyn Monroe, she loves number 5 Chanel, and this is because of the presence of the RNS linalool from Aniba rosedora, which gives it a very unique smell. Okay, so much about plants. What's the relevance of it now? If you look at the generation as it goes from 2000 BC down to 2010, Anno Domini, previously people rely on traditional medicine. You see this old man here and this old Asian man here. This is from Africa. And that was years ago. But now you see again another guy in South America with all those traditional medicine in front of him and pakcik, ubat rasdong. So everybody, even now, they're still relying on plants. Okay? So that shows plants has never lost its importance. even though with all the development in pharmaceutical industry. So it's back to the nature. So Malaysia is very lucky. We have a huge biodiversity. We keep saying it all the time. We are 10th in the world, 4th in Asia. We've got the biggest flower in the world. And we've got the most number of flowering plants. And out of these, 2,000 is medicinal in value. Okay? And apart from that, we've got all the other fauna, millions and millions of microbes and invertebrates, which has still yet to be explored. So Malaysia has to pick up and try and take advantage of this wealth. The rainforest biodiversity in Malaysia is 15,500, and you compare this with the US, which has the biggest farmers, is only 9,000. And Germany, with the biggest market in herbal medicine, they only have 2,600, but they are much more advanced than us. So what are Malaysians doing? What are Malaysia doing? What are the Asian countries doing? We have so much wealth, and we're not really exploiting them to our advantage. So I believe traditional knowledge that we have in our ethnic communities, be it Chinese, Indians, or even the Orang Asli, together with our huge biodiversity, has a higher probability of giving us the new medicine of the future. Okay, let's start about my journey. Well, I don't want to say my journey, it's our journey. I prefer to say me and my friends at the laboratory Hasilan Semula Jadi. I know them since year 2000. That's the start of the millennia. That was when Prof. Nordin was heading the laboratory Phytoubatan back then. It was a very small shed. It was a shed, actually, turned into a lab. Very small lab. It was the only lab that was available, and we had 30 students working in that lab. And some of them are actually here today. I'm very proud to say. We have Rohaya, we have Farida, I think many more. And now in 2012, we were given a new building. Thank you very much, UPM, for having the trust on us. Where we have more than one lab. Now we've got a bioassay facilities there, we've got spectroscopy facilities there, we've got synthesis facilities, and we are very happy to get this, and then we are working very, very hard to fulfill UPM's expectations. So since the millennia, I've been working with the LHS on various projects. So this is showing some of the facilities that we have at the lab right now. You are very welcome to come and visit and collaborate with us and work with us. So our approach in the LHS, or National Products Research in LHS, we undertake about four basic approaches, which is the usual chemotaxonomy, which has been very useful in the last decade. And we also rely on traditional knowledge, especially the medicinal knowledge. And we also try our luck with serendipity. You know, we just take whatever is available and screen them and find activity. And now we are actually slowly moving into a shift in paradigm in using systems biology approach. And for our lab, we are very very good with our platform technology, NMR and MASS. So we use this a lot in our omics, specifically metabolomics or metabonomics when it comes to biofluids. So I'm going to talk about our travel, our use of these approaches in trying to find something useful from our plants. Okay, so just to get a brief insight into how we isolate or we obtain active principles from plants. Some of you here might not be aware. It's a very tedious process. It's not a straightforward thing. You don't just extract and get everything out directly. It requires a lot of perseverance. You have to extract, you have to fractionate, and then all this uses very high technology chromatographic methods. And then you've got the purified constituents. Looks like a powder, but you need to have the molecular structures. And this is where you got to have some spectroscopic inputs there, so we have to actually map, like a jigsaw puzzle, the molecular connections, the atomic connections between the molecules. So this requires milligram quantities, so the separation is also very difficult and tedious. Then, we want to have a purpose in our isolation. We don't want to isolate just anything, so we want to isolate something very, very useful. So we try to use in situ kind of or online identification of structures as well as biological activity. So we use a bioactivity guided fractionation approach where we look at bioactivity and try to relate with the structures. So then we are actually isolating something useful from a plant and cutting down on the cost, of course. So this is a reductionist approach which have been useful, although it has its disadvantages, especially with traditional medicine. Because traditional medicine is a combination of many molecules working together. Whereas when you do a reductionist approach, you are actually isolating them from the rest of the molecules. So in this, in that sense, you might be also losing activity. So over the years, I'll skip this one. This is talking about the need for amounts. Okay. Well, target analysis, you are actually targeting single molecule. But the challenge now is actually working with extracts, for example, from a herbal extract, which contains millions and millions of molecules. And what do we do with this? We've got to actually profile them properly, dereplicate, and identify what's in that which is useful to us. So it's like looking for a needle in a haystack. So it's very difficult. So now we try to use metabolomics approach, because this is an ideally a comprehensive analytical approach which is non-selective and universally applicable to identify and quantify all metabolites in the metabolome, in the biological biological sample. So we've got all the platforms there is. I mean, platforms, the platform technologies like the NMR and LC-MS are so much sophisticated now, so sturdy, so robust. You can look at more lower than microgram, even to the nanogram scale, you can actually identify stuff. So great hope for phytochemistry in general. This is the holistic approach. And for our lab, we've been focusing on research groups where we screen libraries of natural products. We want to discover effective enzyme inhibitors especially, or even things that work on cells. When we study the fundamentals, because we get a lot of grant from the fundamental grants from Ministry of Education, so we look at mechanism of action. And then we also do synthesis, derivatization, to look at the structure-activity relationship studies. And of course, we now go into metabolomics and metabolomics in order to understand how a plant medicinal properties happen, how we can understand what is actually interacting and how it happens. So we've got assays established at the lab comprising enzymes, cells, and as well as animal assays, as well as microbial assays. Now we are venturing into zebrafish model assays, which we are setting up. And our disease target has always been inflammation and diabetes mellitus, although we did spend some time with cancer, malaria, and Alzheimer before. So, molecule hunting in the rainforest. This is me and my friends, and I think it was a trip in Royal Belum Forest, years ago. We managed to get a lot of plants, which we have been working. Many of the students got their PhD and masters working on the plants that we collect from Belum Forest, as well as Endau Rumpin. And I'd like just to highlight a few of these. For example, the Garcinia. We have many species of Garcinia, which is endemic to Malaysia. And Garcinia is very famous for having xanthones. This is actually Professor Gwen's passion, xanthones. So we are working actually on this as well. And xanthones are very good with cancer cells. They are cytotoxic. Where the Garcinias of Malaysia, I think you know about manggis, you know about asam glugo, asam kandis. These are just a few species, the common ones. But of course, there are other more difficult to find, which are in the forest. I'll show you in a while. Garcinias, they are prolific producers of xanthones and related compounds, which has very complex structures. And of course, it comes from the shikimate acetate pathway. And up to date, we have, there is about 175 xanthones reported in literature. And the Garcinia species which we collected includes Banchana, Cantaliana, Mangai, Negroninata, Opaca, and loads of others. But we were interested in the ones that gave us a good property to look at. So we did an assay on this Garcinia species that we collected. And we identified three, which is of utmost interest. And I think I'll just talk about Cantaliana today, because this is the one where we isolated some very interesting-looking molecules, which are the cage xanthones. This cage xanthones is a very big challenge for synthetic chemists. In the US, there are several groups actually trying to effect the total synthesis of the cage xanthones. I wish we had more money so that we can do organic synthesis here, but it is very expensive and very slow process. So we focus on identifying them and characterizing them. So we've got about six of the new cage xanthones, and we tested this, And lo and behold, some of them are really, really strong in terms of its cytotoxic activities. This was done by a Jordanian student years ago. Khalid is not here today. But this shows the cytotoxic activities of this Cantalianon ABCD. It is very good in terms of comparison with the standard. But still, for cancer drugs, what they're looking for, NCI is looking for at activities which is less than 0.1 microgram per mil in terms of activity. So ours was not as potent as what we would like. But still, we persevere. And at this moment, we have not found any more Garcinia. But inshallah, in the future, if we find, it will be interesting to study what the structures would be like in there. Okay, and I had also another student, a very good student, who decided to take up the challenge of working with saponins from a soapberry family. Saponins are very well known to be very complex in terms of isolation as well as characterization. And we were interested in saponins because it came up positive in our assay for acetylcholinesterase. It inhibits this neurotransmitter at the synaptic cleft. So what is AKE actually? AKE is the one that is implicated in Alzheimer's disease, a degenerative disease that attacks and destroys the brain cells. And due to Alzheimer's disease, we have loss of memory and accompanied by behavioral problems, agitation, aggression, incontinence, etc., and even hallucinations. So this is a very serious disease. I know my neighbor who actually died already because of Alzheimer's disease before she could be treated by any new drugs. So for the isolation of these saponins, it follows, as I said, a bioassay-guided approach where we found the activity concentrated in the ethylized state and the water. So when a student heard that you've got activity in the water extract, they panic because they say, I cannot work on the water extract because it's going to be a very, very big challenge. I will never finish my PhD. Okay, so my student, she took it up and she finished her PhD in good time. And we found the saponins to be the bioactive constituents. We tested that. This is the isolation. We tested it and we found the zero spermocytes and various other triterpenoids, quite a number of them from the Xerospermum neuronianum or rambutan pacat. The elucidation was, of course, very, very tedious, but it was done. A phytochemist's job is always get the structure first before you worry about whether it's potent or not. So that's what she focused on. And this shows just how we try to identify. We look for the saponin structure by looking at the triterpenoid that's attached to sugars. We minus that one out, and then only we work on the sugar constituents via LC-MS. So via LC-MS, we were able to track the different sugars on the main molecule and work out by NMR the linkage to the molecule, and that establishes the structures. And we did this for at least four of the huge saponins. Then, of course, it doesn't stop there. Once you get the structures, we elucidate that we have elucidated. We tested for the activities, in this case, against anti-AKE. But this is where I'm afraid bad news comes in again. This is the reductionist approach, the result of the reductionist approach. We break up the extract into single molecules, and many times we will lose activity. So as a whole, the extract is active, but when you separate them individually, they become inactive or becomes moderate active. But this is part and parcel of life. We still plod on. And then this one is just to highlight some work we did with Kacip Fatima. Everybody here knows Kacip Fatima, I guess. This is the very famous herb for the women. For the men, you've got Tongkat Ali or Eurycoma longifolia. So my group focused on Kacip Fatima, not to find out the hormonal or whatever, but more on what's in this Kacip Fatima. And we found that Kacip Fatima is actually contains rather an irritant class of compounds, which we call the resorcinol. Okay, so resorcinols are known to cause skin irritation. So do not handle it with your hands too much because you're going to get some inflammation on your skin. But apart from that, it also contains this labisalquinone, which became the marker for this particular plant in terms of quality control for the herbal industry. So we were interested to see how these compounds behave in a cell assay. So we had we had enough of the resorcinol, especially we didn't have enough of the labisaquinones, so we only tested the resorcinols, and we saw that they have very good anti-cancer properties as well. So, I don't know, maybe there's some future ahead for this plant in terms of cancer treatment, but someone has to study that. Okay, at the same time, we were interested to see varieties of this labisia. So we were challenged because we are using animal-based metabolomics. So we wanted to see what's the difference between all these varieties of Labisia pumila. Orang kampung said they use the fat one, and somebody said, oh, I use the thin one. So what's the difference between the fat leaf Labisia pumila variety alata, and how does it differ from Labisia pumila variety pumila and Labisia pumila variety lanceolata? So we did a PCA. We collected the extracts and do proton NMR metabolomics. Look at the NMR and found that when we do a multivariate analysis, they are well separated from each other. So this allows us to look into the constituents or chemical constituents that tell us why these things are discriminated. And we found that, you know, alata, the fat leaf, labisia versus the pumila, the thin leaf, there are some differences in the aromatic compounds that's in the pumila. And in the alata, we've got something there which is an aldehyde, which is not present in the pumila. So this is actually a new finding, just to shock some people. Okay, and then we also saw differences in the pumila versus the lanceolata. But this is actually just in the amount of the constituents that's present there. So this is actually very useful for quality control of herbal medicine later on, because you want to be sure that when you buy Kacik Fatima, you get the right variety for a particular property. So if that property has to have the aromatic compounds more than the rest, then you want to have that one. So this one can be used actually to actually pinpoint. And as consumers, I think you should require that in whatever you buy off the shelf. Okay, now to the next highlight, which is an anti-asthmatic small molecule that we isolated from a plant named Melicope telefolia. But the Malay name is a little bit embarrassing to sebut, Setenggek Burung. Now they call me Professor Setenggek Burung. Never mind. But what we got from here is a very interesting small molecule. It's not a novel molecule. It's a known molecule synthesized by someone a long time ago. But it came as a natural product from the Setenggek Burung. And it is good for inhibiting 5-lipoxygenase. 5-lipoxygenase is actually implicated in asthma because it produces the leukotrienes. And this leukotrienes is the one that causes the mucus secretion in your in the bronchiole. For example, here you see a normal bronchiole where you can see air can pass through. But when it's clogged by the leukotrienes, and you see that the bronchiole becomes very tight. So air cannot pass through, so you have difficulties in breathing. My son, Irshad, suffers from asthma. So this is actually something I bought for my son. Okay? I'm so happy that I got to this stage, but of course, I'm not anywhere close to developing a drug, but at least I'm actually contributing to the world of anti-asthma. So Melicope is something that you eat dengan sambal, okay? So Setenggek Burung as an ulam. It's well known as something that keeps you young. So from this, we were interested before because it shows that it has anti-inflammation. So we tested it in our assay, and an Indonesian girl was very happy to work on it, and she got few compounds out. But the most interesting one is of course this trihydroxygeranyl acetophenone, which we call THGA. We can make this very easily in 6 hours. I think we can top that if we have time. It shows inhibition of the LTC4, the leukotriene release, and it has very strong activity in comparison to the standard. And when we try against 5-LOX, which comes from the human source, we found that the activity is actually retained. It is reproducible. So it shows that in 5-lipoxygenase, our assay was using soybean, so this was using 5 from human source. So it shows that on human, it might work too. So this got my colleague, Professor Daud Israf from Medic Faculty to be interested. And he went further to do the animal model assay. And he found that this THGA is as good as Ziluton, which is the currently used drug for asthma. It controls lung function. It reduces cellular infiltration. It reduces goblet cell hyperplasia, whatever that is, but it has to do with, you know, removing some of those mucus things from the bronchioles. So it's active both parenterally and orally. It helps somebody breathe. So this is very exciting to us. So we cannot do more in terms of chemistry in that sense. So we give all our synthetic material to Dawood. So he is pursuing it with his students. So perhaps in his inaugural lecture, he will talk more about this, his studies on this compound. Whereas we go back to our synthesis lab and see whether we can do something with the THGA to make it more effective, to make it more medicine-friendly and so on. So this is just a summary of the properties that we found with THGA together with the medic faculty, Dawood's group. So what we wanted to do was to see whether we can enhance the bioactivity of THGA itself. So we synthesized several THGA analogs, and then we look at the activity again using our in-house 15-log soybean assay. And then we want to see in the molecular interaction. And then we, of course, had to use some computational tools. And we got that through, I think you everybody remembers Dr. Bimo last time. And as well, we are working with UKM. They've got very nice facilities for docking, sea docking. So we did this, and we synthesized some analogs. We obtained some e-science funds, managed to convince them. And we synthesized about, I think, 12 analogs, but we were able only to get them, get to test, because when we synthesize compounds, sometimes the problem is we cannot get it to be a very soluble substance. So we have problem with solubility in order to do our assay. So we managed to get this one soluble and test for the bioactivity, and alhamdulillah, we found that the activity can be enhanced somewhat by making the modifications, elongating the chain length or adding a different SR groups, for example, and we have improved the activity somewhat quite well. So chain elongation of the SR substituent, introduction of aromatic moiety significantly improved the inhibitory activity of this THGA. So in the drug discovery process, what we're doing now is actually lead optimization. You know, lead optimization and improving on the lead molecule. And of course, we do docking studies to see to simulate how it actually binds in the biological system. And we published a paper on this recently where we proposed that the compounds, THGA, as well as the analogs, actually combine, align in the cavity of the receptor site in the same way as the LOX substrate. So meaning that it competes with the LOX substrate in that cavity, so it prevents the formation of the enzyme inhibition. So it inhibited the enzyme. So this is showing the other analogs that have been subjected to the same treatment, and we can see here, this is our drug, it sits there in a line, and the yellow one is the LOX substrate, so it sort of mimics the way the LOX substrate sits in the receptor site. So my student has she did that under her master's, and now she has converted to a PhD, where she is still pursuing more analogs on this particular compound. Okay, so we've been using a lot of reductionist approach so far, and we have been trying to find active biomolecules. So starting about 3 years ago, we met up with a group in Leiden University, Institute of Biology, Professor Robert Vaporte, who introduced us to metabolomics, where, as I say, it's a more holistic approach in trying to understand how a medicinal plant, in particular case, in our case, we wanted to know why herbs act the way they do. So we wanted to know how a whole plant will react in the biological system. So metabolomics is a very good way to actually capture all the effects of a herbal extract. All we do is observe the effects, and then after the observation, we collect all the data, and from the data, we can actually try to explain some of this. So meeting the metabolomics challenge. Metabolomics is a systematic study of the unique chemical fingerprints that specific cellular processes or biochemical perturbations leave behind. It's like a fingerprint. So non-biased identification and quantification of all metabolites in the biological system is actually affected by doing it this way. So it strives to obtain the complete metabolic fingerprints and to detect differences between and then provide the hypothesis to explain why these are different. So this is actually the basis for personalized medicine, actually. So it has applications in various fields, plant classification and derivatizations, differentiation, mainly in agriculture, in quality control of agriculture produce, quality control and assessments, environment, enviro monitoring, plant host interactions and plant bioactivity studies, especially when you are looking at in agricultural produce where it gets attacked by pests. So this is a good way to use to actually observe at the fluxome level. It's also very much used in food chemistry, in medicine. It's used for biomarker discovery. I think right now people are developing via metabolomics ways to diagnose very quickly people who have cancer or what kind of cancer or all the other as diagnosis. So there is a tremendous increase in publication in metabolomics as well as metabolomics in the past 2 years alone. It's very difficult to catch up. And it's also used in toxicology, clinical toxicology. I think one of the very well-known figure, Nicholson, won a Nobel Laureate Award for his contribution in the field of systems biology via metabolomics. Okay, so general flow for metabolomics, we will always start with questions. The first thing you do in metabolomics is ask the right questions. What are your questions? In our case, we want to know, are there any difference between samples, between biological specimens? And what are these differences? So we have to observe by our data, from our data. And then we have to explain what are the reasons for these differences. So this is why this is very much different from the reductionist approach. Reductionist approach is always fine, 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 until you get it. And then you get it, it's suddenly it's not the one that you want. But in metabolomics, we just throw everything and then we observe first. And then using the observation, we cunningly, with information, we select the right one. So that is the philosophy behind metabolomics in a simplified form. So I want to talk about Centella. Everybody knows Centella? It's my mama's favorite ulam, pegaga. Okay, in my kampung, there are many, many variety of pegaga. If you look at the backyard, sometimes it is a very big leafy leaf, or sometimes they're very thin, very tiny, very spiky. So these are different varieties of Centella asiatica. It's not even called Centella asiatica. Some of them have a different name. But the locals call it pegaga, pegaga, pegaga. Okay? So we are interested in pegaga because it has some properties against diabetes mellitus, according to the traditional folklore. So we pick up, and this is also one of the top herb which has been earmarked by the Ministry of Agriculture. Top 10, or is it top 5 of the herbs that the industry wants to market. So we selected this, and these are our questions. We've got Centella asiatica, and we also got another pegaga, which the people up north use it for juicing to make cocktails, which is called Hydrocotyl bonariensis. And then in the backyard, you'll find the tiny ones, look like rumput, you know, some herbicide. Something that kacau your garden. So this is Hydrocotyl cyptopyriodis. So I think botanists can correct me if I pronounce wrongly. Are they similar in the chemical characteristics? That's what we want to know. And well, people use it for diabetes, but are they all effective for diabetes? That's our question. And if they are different, we want to know what makes them different. What are the metabolic discriminators? And if they're different in activity, we want to know why. So that will tell us what actually is giving the antidiabetic properties. So the first question. So we went ahead and carried out the using the Nature Protocol method that was already published by the Leiden group in terms of the collection and preparation of the plant tissue. Now, in metabolomics, it's always very important to ensure that your sample is a good sample. It's not a sample that has been degraded because of enzyme activity and drying, whatever. So what my students do is that when they take a plant, they take the plant at a certain point of the day. If it's 9 o'clock, it's 9 o'clock sharp. They will go the next day for the same plant at 9 o'clock. So the time must be the right time, must be the same time. And then when they cut a leaf, they will immediately quench in nitrogen, liquid nitrogen, to arrest all enzymatic activity. So when we take out at that point, there's no more changes to the chemical profile of a leaf. So some people might be seeing some of my students going with the nitrogen tank in the, in kat masa dekat ladang. The other day there was an explosion. It's because they are trying to get their samples with the liquid nitrogen, you know, to preserve the validity of the biological and the chemical profile. So this is a little bit tedious for metabolomics, but that's the only one that's a bit dangerous. The rest are all very plain and easy. We use proton NMR most of the time because this gives us the first macro look about what we have, untargeted, and then using spectral pre-processing softwares and so on and so forth. There's a huge amount of data in the NMR spectrum. It looks like a line, but it's actually it covers everything in the leaf metabolome. Everything is there. So information is very rich. So we process it using multivariate analysis, and then we do some treatment, and then it will show patterns that tell some story behind the distribution. So this is what C. acetica, bonariensis, and Cyptorpaides looks like on the NMR. Of course, being chemists, the first thing we do from the NMR, we tear it to bits. We identify ourselves using databases and our skills in identification. Those peaks will mean something to us. So number 9, for example, is a fatty acid peak. Number 8 is actually a beta glucose peak there. And if you look at number 7 there, number 5, that's indicating you've got the chemical markers for Centella acetica, the aceticoside. So we were able to do this because of our long history in phytochemistry. So we have identified those. And of course, we try to validate whatever we identify via two-dimensional NMR as well. And we identify other components like the flavonoids and so on. And this is our result from the three, C. acetica, bonariensis, Cyptorpaides. Okay, we did the multivariate analysis and we found that all three varieties are very different from each other. But we are interested in C. acetica. It is very far from the other two. This is bonariensis, this is Cyptorpaides. At least these two, they belong to the same genus, Hydrocotyle. But Centella is definitely a different genus. And it is totally, from here, chemically very different from the Hydrocotyle. So what's the difference? We look at the loading plot. So when you do a score plot, you will always look at the loading plot. This loading plot is the one that you look at the real raw data, is the chemical shift that tells you the characteristics of the chemicals that differentiates your clusters. So we found that the Centella acetica is the one which has higher amounts of the chemical marker, the mydicacic acid, the centellulose, the aceticoside, whereas the Hydrocotyle, they are rich in fats, they are rich in amino acids. Perhaps that's why as a juice, Hydrocotyle bonariensis is very good. As juice, it's very fatty, manis, sedap. So that could be it. Anyway, we've got that far. And then, of course, we validate our findings further with LC-MS to make sure that we are identifying the right one. So we now know that Centella is very different from Hydrocotyle and the two Hydrocotyles because it carries the chemical markers, whereas the two Hydrocotyles may not have these markers. So then we ask this question again, are they all effective against diabetes? If Hydrocotyle are also effective against diabetes, then we are back to square one, right? So we want to have that Centella is active. Then it can explain that maybe the centellulosides are the ones that's causing the activity for anti-diabetic. So, well, everybody knows about diabetes mellitus. It's a chronic metabolic disorder, high blood glucose concentration due to insulin deficiency, and sometimes usually with insulin resistance. And cause are usually due to genetics, environment, what we eat, and maybe combinations of these. Okay, very cute boy there, but I don't want to have a son like that. I will have a heartache to get him back to, to a slim figure. So, worldwide prevalence of diabetes. I don't have the one for Malaysia here. I lost the slide somehow. Currently, 240 million people worldwide suffers from this disease, and it's expected to increase drastically by 2025. I think Malaysia is one of the top countries having people suffering from diabetes mellitus type 2. Between type 2 and type 1, type 2 is the most difficult to handle. So diabetes mellitus type 2 diabetes or non-insulin dependent diabetes mellitus ranges from insulin resistance, insulin deficiency, predominantly secretory defect with insulin resistance. And complications are due to prolonged vascular damage. We have chronic micro and macrovascular vascular disorders, including stroke. People always associate stroke, does not associate with diabetes. But actually, if you suffer from diabetes, it's easy for you to also get stroke. And type 2 diabetes and obesity, which is actually pre-diabetes state, have been reported to be independent risk factors for acute ischemic stroke and other cardiovascular diseases. So please cut down on sugar. So in our work, we use an animal model. At this time, we did not develop the zebrafish yet, but now we are berusaha ke arah itu. So we use a OBDB, obese and diabetic rats model. This model demonstrates many metabolic disturbances similar to human type 2 diabetes. So you see here the rat is very fat. We make it fat. This is the original control rat, and this is the fat rat. So we kejam. Sorry. So my heart ached when we had to do this. We had to kill many rats. Anyway, so before we do the work, we still wonder whether Centella have any effect on any on a diabetic state. So we use a type 1 model to confirm, and it showed that Centella does have activity. Excuse me. So Centella is effective against diabetes, although it is type 1. So we set up our Centella using the OBDB mouse. So it took us 3 months to actually get the rats to be fat. So I think Diani made a lot of biscuits and fed her rats so that it's really, really fat. So after 3 months, we stopped. And okay, rats, we're going to give you some Centella instead. So the rats were given Centella acetica, and another group was given the hydrocortisone bonarensis. We didn't try with ciprofloxacin because there's not enough sample. And then we also compare with metformin, the drug used for diabetes. And of course, we have to have a control group. So when the rats were made, the diabetes, how they were made diabetes is that we inject them, once they are fed, we inject a very low dose of streptozotocin, enough not to damage the pancreas so that the insulin production is still okay. If you damage the pancreas, then it's type 1. Okay, so we want to have a type 2, something that mimics type 2. So what we did was, after the treatment over several weeks, my students did it, smelly stuff. So they collected the urine samples, and of course, using a protocol, they collect the urine samples, they preserve the validity of the samples over 3 weeks. And then these samples, they run the proton NMR. And then we compare the proton NMR of all the urine samples of each of the rat in the four groups, treated groups. Then we look at the, we use multivariate analysis again to see the distribution of this proton NMR in terms of how they cluster. So if you can follow me with this one, this one here, which is this, is the non-diabetic. This one is the obese rat, the blue one. And T2D means type 2 diabetes. And this is the one here. So this is the control group. This is the metabolite changes when we treat. So this is not treated with Centella acetica. This is the control group. You can see that a normal group is separate from the type 2 diabetic group, separate from the obese group, based on their urine alone. Okay, we have not looked at the blood. At this time, we don't collect the blood. We only collect the blood at the end. Okay? We don't want to kill the rats too much, too fast. Okay, so this is the one which is the control. And then we compare with the one that we observe from the urine collected from the rat's fat with Centella asiatica. So again, we collected initial, middle and final, meaning first week, second week and the final week. So these are actually given in the colors here. So the final week is in blue, the initial week is in red, and the middle week is the yellow. Okay, this is the baseline. Baseline meaning the rats are diabetic state just before they were given Centella. So here, these are the green stuff which is the diabetic. Once they get the Centella extract, you will find that this is the initial. Okay, so this initial is without, they're not diabetic yet, okay? This one is diabetic. So initial red is the group is here. But when they are diabetic, it moves to the left. You see the trajectory. And then when they are diabetic, it sees that the trajectory moves to the normal side. This is the normal side where it is not diabetic. So it indicates that Centella is actually doing something to the rats. It's reducing the glucose. It's getting better in that sense. Okay, and finally, it is quite close to the initial state there. Okay, but when we look at the effects on the rat treated with hydrocortil, this is the initial urine, and when they are made diabetic, there's the green one, and then when they are fed with hydrocortil, the trajectory remains on this side. It doesn't go back here, so it has not moved back to the normal state. So that shows that hydrocortil is not affecting. It's not affecting the diabetic rats in the way that Centella asiatica is. Okay, and this is actually an in vivo assay. It's not an in vitro enzyme inhibition and so on. It's an in vivo. It's a whole animal model assay. And then we look at metformin. Metformin, we expect it to reduce the glucose, so it should be better. And indeed, you can see a trajectory moving back to the normal side. But lo and behold, it's not giving the same effect as Centella asiatica. Both seems to be affecting diabetes mellitus condition, making it better, but metformin is bringing the rat to a different place. Centella, it went here, but metformin is up there. The final one is up here. So that shows that metformin, the effect, molecularly perhaps, is different from the Centella asiatica's effect. So this is good news for us because we want to know what is making this difference between metformin and Centella asiatica. Is there something dangerous that we need to know about using the current drug? So what are the metabolic discriminators? We studied this further. We look at the biochemical measurement. This is made by friends in the medic, of course, and we compared the Centella asiatica treated rats biofluids to the one treated with metformin, and we found that for the one treated metformin, there is a huge increase in creatinine in the biofluids, whereas in the Centella asiatica, the creatinine level is normal. So somehow the drug has actually caused a side effect on somebody who takes it. That's why metformin banyak-banyak makan is not good actually. You have to follow a dose, and prolonged use is actually not the best. So that shows us that something natural like Centella asiatica could be a better alternative if anybody wants to consider that. And then we want to make sure that our work is actually validated. We make sure we make the measurements for the glucose and insulin. And here, looking at the baseline and final measurement, you can see that Centella asiatica does lower glucose, whereas hydrocortil bonaerensis, this one here, blue, up here, does not seem to be lowering the glucose level. Whereas for the insulin level, this is where I said type 2 must be, the insulin must be functioning. So Centella asiatica does not seem to inhibit the insulin production, whereas metformin, red one, is actually does. It somehow destroys the pancreas a little bit. And so does hydrocortil bonaerensis. So that's what we can say. But of course, these are still very early days. We need to do a lot more studies. People from the medical faculty may have to do a lot more preclinical studies on this effect. We're just using our metabolomics binoculars to actually figure out what goes on in the biofluids in case it can tell us something. So we can never do work alone. We have to work in a team. So we're just doing our part of the work. So some reflections before I end. So much work has been done. How many years? 15 years here in IBS. Hunting for molecules. So where's the drug, Kuzira? Cannot answer. Because drug discovery is a very long process and very expensive. If you're lucky, you get it. You're always most likely to be unlucky. How to improve the success rate in finding truly novel structures and useful bioactive compounds? That's our question. We always want to improve our success rate. If there's anything new, more promising, we'll try it. Okay? So bioassay guided approach versus serendipity, that's a very smart way to do it. Serendipity can be very, very expensive, although it's fun. Yeah? I think for students, they want to try serendipity because they just want to get molecules out. They don't care about bioactivity. Synergism in plant medicines, that's a challenge because how do you deal with that? Have we got the right assays to deal with synergism? Even metabolomics is still early days to really say whether we can tell, we can handle synergism. Synergism is very important. It's like you remove an arm from a person, you don't function well. You remove two arms, you function even worse. So synergism is having everything complete. So in a herbal extract, in a plant extract, you remove one, you say, oh, very strong anti-cancer drug, but it has got a lot of side effects. That's because Allah made it that a herbal extract is complete. Ada ubat, ada racun. Ada racun, ada ubat. So it's balanced. So this is what we mean by synergism, my point of view. And reductionist versus holistic, of course, both has advantages, depends on what's your aim. And this is something I like. We need to have a renewed vision for natural products because we have so much wealth here in the country. And before another banjir berlaku, we've got to do something about that. And I believe metabolomics is the future pathway to evidence-based and personalized medicine because it can tell us so much. It's a data-rich, and you need data in order to understand something. And the platform technologies are so excellent now, you are pushing it right to the limits. Challenges, of course, technical challenge, separation, purification, always be there. Human resource and expertise, this is very worrying because we need good students. We need good people, good researchers, and who are committed. Instrumentation, we buy something 15 years ago, now it's kaput. We got to buy new ones. We want to do those challenging stuff, high tech. We want to do cutting edge work. So we have to have cutting edge instruments. Cost and speed and access to reagents. We've got to settle this with the Ministry of Trade. We're getting our chemicals so late. 6 months to 8 months. Forget synthesis. Relevance, consistency, reliability. That's your technical skills in reproducibility. Academic obligations and constraints. The quality of knowledge. We must drive our students to go for knowledge because we have to love knowledge. Not because knowledge will give you better pay or better career pathway. Financial, get the private sector to do something. I've been telling this to MOA, get them to fund research rather than just give them money and then give us money and give them the technology. Please fund the research somehow, some percentage of it. And out there, global healthcare gap is happening. Decreasing discovery efficiency and increasing drug resistance from the 1,556 new medicines approved in the past 30 years, only 20 were diseases prevalent in our world, in the developing world. Those big pharmas are not going to care about us. They want to make money. So who can care? Who is supposed to care about us? It's us, ourselves. We have to be the one to find it or push these people to find it. The average cost of developing new drug, as I said, is very, very expensive. Forget about developing one. Even with a calendar-like history, give it to the NCI. It's so expensive. But we have a way. This is the drug discovery pathway. We cannot go here, but there are ways we can get involved here. We can identify the leads for these people. We've got the bioresources where that comes from, huge amount of it. So why don't we identify them and provide them with the lead molecules for drug development with a good protection, of course, in our agreement, get something back, royalties. that sort of thing. So this is where I think Malaysia stands a good chance, but we need to actually coordinate our efforts, collate our efforts, need to have a rethinking of our mindset and commitment. So the way forward, the nexus between chemistry and biology is the future of natural product science. Real cure will come only when chemical basis of the disease is adequately understood, and the route to better success is productive collaboration between the informed chemists and biologists together. You can never walk alone. So chemistry offers answers to the how, and biology seeks answers to the why. So it's a good gandingan. Creating values, we must recognize numerous plants around the world which might bring benefit to humankind. And our goal is to find, as scientists, our goal is to find them and demonstrate that they are safe and efficacious. Like Robert Frost said, I really like this quote, "What's in a weed? A plant whose values has yet to be discovered. And we are the discoverer." So nature still represents a feasible way to develop new medicines for global health. And natural products gives a good head start in the quest for these new agents, new directions for future medicines. Thus, natural product companies out there, all my students, all my colleagues, continue in concert with your biology friends and clinicians alike, explore the nature's small molecules for future cures. So that ends my lecture. Finally, I would like to say my greatest appreciation to Universiti Putra Malaysia for giving me this career path, for taking me in as an academic in year 2001. I hope I have served UPM well up to now, and I, inshallah, I hope to serve more. And suddenly, I'm tongue-tied. I don't know who to appreciate. Well, I want to thank everybody, actually, especially Prof. Nordin, who's sitting right in front there, for his belief in me. And my friends at the Laboratory Hasilan Semulajadi, I think I can't see very well. It's quite dark. But I see Rohaya, my student, my ex-student. Okay. Prof. Daud, Prof. Rob, Prof. Young, Farida, Intan, Alfi, Yaya, Nabil in Yemen somewhere. Maulidani coming back soon, inshallah. All the LHS staff, for all that you have done for me and us as the group, and all the students, you are the one that makes it happen. I cannot stand here without you. Without your work, I get nothing. And I would also like to give my to say my appreciation to the secretariat who helped to organize this very nice event for me. It's quite a surprise. I thought it was just a normal routine stuff, but it's quite nice here to have everybody listening to my talk for at least 1 hour, or is it more than 1 hour? Okay. And what else? Who should I thank? Oh yeah. Last and not least, I must thank my faculty. Of course, I forgot to thank my boss there, Dr. Zed, Faculty of Science. I teach there, of course, although I do my research in IBS. So I should thank also Prof. Rahman of IBS for giving me the support, and my current boss, Datuk, for having a strong belief that I can carry out my job at RMC and also allow me to do research at the same time. And lastly, I want to thank my mom and Arwah Papa for giving birth to me and taking care of me, and also to my husband, who cannot be here today, but I know he's here. And I would just like to say thank you so much for standing by through all the hardships. And thank you for making the natural products, my 5 kids, together with me. So, assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and big congratulations to Professor Khosrau. Why not we give her a big round of applause? Yeah, because the applause that you give just now was not loud enough. So I'm not satisfied with that. But anyway, let me say something about this. I think she has done a great amount of work. You know, it's actually one of the phytochemical, the natural product is one of my interest area. I cannot go so much into that area because I'm a vet. What vet can do? Counting animals only, maybe. So you can see that there are hundreds of thousands of plants species in the wild. But I've gone through all those, what we call the list of plants. And she always mentions about Centella, what else? Kacik Fatima, and all those stuff. But I just wonder why Toka Ali is not in the list. All for ladies. You know that, what if not second Centella is not good for men, right? Am I right? If I'm not second, it can reduce number of sperms. So for those people that would like to go for bigger family, I think Centella is not good for that. Unless you know the accurate dosage. Let me take an opportunity to share with you. I'm not going to dwell further into whatever she has delivered just now. It's a splendid amount of work, lots of informations there. I'm sure that the students are really proud of her, and the deans here. The deans and the current dean, the previous dean must be very proud of her. And I'm also very proud of her, not because I'm what I'm now. I was with her last time, 2004-2005, when I was at IBS. And then we were together. Of course, we have Pranodin come back here. Welcome back, Pranodin. Thank you very much to be with us. Then I know this. What to share with you something beyond what the talk that she delivered right now about the overall research UPM. You can see that, you know, she's one of the best examples, despite lots of handicaps, constraints, in terms of fundings, in terms of human resource, in terms of brains, maybe. I remember since year 2004 until today, Prof. Nordin as well, Prof. Zira, they never giving up on me, asking for funding to maintain NMR. Am I right? They never give up. So there is a quality. Of course, I have to be very, what we call it, very strong too. If I don't have money, of course, I have no money here. It's actually use this money and it's built the money that we have, if we have, belongs to everybody here. So within that constraints, you know, things move forward. You know, that is one, that's splendid. But here, these days, you know, there are lots of challenges. The challenges, you know, we all here, human resource always pinpoint. We don't have enough funding. University is not giving money. Faculty is claiming here and there. I'm not supposed to be here. I'm supposed to be faculty, you know, because if I'm here, faculty is going to be very weak. So all of this actually boils down to the person, to the manpower itself. If manpower, the human resource, is not strong and doesn't know how to bring things and move forward in a positive way, then we'll never be there. So it's not about money. Money actually belongs to everybody. UPM cannot give you that money. And where are we going to get, let's say, funding? We all must work together to achieve, to get that funding. So let's say if UPM is doing something, Wulsan try to arrange something, we don't have funding, especially right now, you know, to share with you. Sad, because in principle, compared to last 2 years ago, funding for the operation UPM, even to pay salary, our salary, is already cut almost 50%. So can you see that? And let me share with you, TNCPI, taking care, try to take care the interests of everybody in UCIS, 16 faculties, 10 institutes, we're talking about 26 different centers, Pusat and Institute. And each faculty have funding, how much now getting? 100,000 maybe per DCM, right? Maybe more. You know how much we're getting? TNCPI? 50,000 only. So we are worse off. 50,000 ringgit, can you imagine that we have to take care of the interests of everybody? It is not because UPM so what we call this cruel to us. It's not because of that. UPM, who are UPM? We all. But funding is going to be very challenging, and it is changing now, and the next year is going to be challenging. And we all of us must work together, must be very creative to address this issue. If you don't work together, you just pinpoint you and you not doing right things, and all of us will never get it right for UPM. So who UPM? What is UPM? It's not VC, it's not TNC, it's not the Dekan, it's not the Dean, it's actually we all. So bear in mind. So only what we call this, moving forward, you know, is very tough, but the tough will get going. So I quite heard one word, one phrase here. What's in wit, you know, she mentioned about that. I will ask back, what's in us? What's in all of us? So define that, find the answer, make us, you know, greater than ever. I know that the demand from pengurusan for management is higher and higher, KPI is higher. It's not because of our doing, it's because of the government wants it, but we all must be smart enough how to address that. How to work together to address that, you know. If you think that the lecturer, if we suffer about it, we actually suffer more. I mean, the management suffer more than that, you see. So the demand is not only from what we call this, the staff, the academics, the demand also from the Kementerian, you know, from the ministries, and then from the cabinets, you know. I got a call yesterday, they asked, cabinet asked, let's say, what UPM's doing, you know, to improve the numbers of human resource in plantation industries. And I didn't have an answer for that, you know. I'm the wrong person to ask that. I mean, to answer that kind of questions. But they asked me to do it, come up with that. UPM must come up with a program to support this. If you don't do it, then UPM's name will be at stakes. Unless we can justify why we do this, why we can't do this. So that's the situation. So inshallah, moving forward, we'll do more, and then I promise I'm actually with everybody, with you all, TNCPR, we'll be always with everyone to help. And then, to tell frankly, we're not detecting anything to say yes or no. Yes or no, the decision to me, made by all of us, maybe represented by a few of us. See? So once again, before I finish, I would like to congratulate again to Professor Khosrah many times. In fact, can be 100 times, because she's one of the greatest contributors, one of the greatest to UPM. Otherwise, she wouldn't be here today. Otherwise, she wouldn't have numbers of postgraduate students already graduated, become lecturers, am I right? And some are already professors, maybe in other universities or maybe abroad. So that's actually something that UC is actually really look forward, you know, to have more people like her and like you all here. So with that, I would like to wish Professor Dr. Khosrah well. Do more research, do more contribution to the society, not only doing research, you know, Centella, because if we do this, I'm afraid, you know, to take Centella, you see. And then get more money. For all of us, not only for you, get more students and get the most. We'll support you. So with that, thank you very much. Bye.
Thank you. Yang berbahagia Profesor Datuk Dr. Muhammad Azmi Muhammad Lila, Deputy Vice Chancellor, Research and Innovation, University Putra Malaysia. Once again, I would like to thank Prof. Khosrah Syari for a very beautiful and inspiring lecture. Please join me for the big applause. The organizer would also like to thank all for attending this inaugural by Professor Dr. Khosrah Syari. Thank you, and please join us for lunch at the foyer on the ground floor of this building. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.